Jouni has been a leader in the development of indexing strategies for the sequences inside of graphical models, starting with research that he did in his PhD, I believe, continuing, which was in Finland, if I remember correctly, and basically showing that it was possible to build a full text index of a directed acyclic graph with the GCSA. And then he's further developed that with the GCSA2 index, which is a kind of way to build indexes for arbitrary variation graphs of any topology, which we use in DGMAP. And was critical to the success of that algorithm. Actually, Danang just presented on it. And then in the last few, also has worked on indexing strategies for haplotypes inside of Pangenome graphs that are related to this work here. And now the mapper Giraffe, which is what Jouni will be presenting on today. So Jouni, yeah, feel free to take it away.
Okay, thank you, Eric. Can you see my slides, or is it the wrong screen this time?
No, we got the right screen. Yeah, I can see your slides well.
Okay. Okay, so thank you. So I'm going to talk about Giraffe Aligner, which is a new pangenomic short read aligner using a graph and a set of haplotypes as the reference. It combines the speed of linear aligners such as PWA with the accuracy of graph-based aligner, basically our old VG map. It's been designed specifically for Illumina reads, ideally paired and 150 base pair reads, where the most sequencing errors are substitutions, which means we can try to align the reads without indels first and only use slower dynamic programming if we can't find a good alignment otherwise. Okay, we restrict the attention to parts that are locally consistent with the haplotypes we have, which helped us to avoid some issues with complex graph regions. Giraffe is a part of the VG toolkit. Paper should be out next week. Meanwhile, if you're interested, you can find the preprint on BioArchive. Okay, so it's a read aligner. First, to the easy part of read alignment. We are interested in two related things: mapping approximate location of the read in the reference, and alignment, the best base-to-base alignment between the read and the reference near the particular mapping. Typical consideration at this point, if we're only interested in the easy part, is mapping speed, fraction of reads that we can map, and fraction of mappings that are correct. If these are our goals, read alignment is not that difficult. Designing aligner has equal parts of science, engineering, and art to it. If we have a good idea, we can follow a mostly principled process using some heuristics and some computational parameters. And almost all read aligners follow some version of the seed and extend approach. First, find seeds, partial alignments using a text index. Then, well, that depends on the kind of reads we have used, either cluster the seeds that should correspond to the same mapping, or if we have long reads, we may chain them into rough alignments. And then extend the seeds into full alignments. We continue exploring promising mappings until we are confident that we have found the best alignment. That's basically the easy part of read alignment. And then the ugly part, mapping quality, means our confidence that we have chosen the correct mapping for the read. Easily expressed as a map Q value, minus 10 times 10 based logarithm of error probability. We cap it usually at 60, which means 1 in 1 million error probability. And in practice, if we look at the error probabilities we get from the read aligners, they are not that well calibrated in practice. How to compute the mapping quality? Basically, we model the probability that if we have a particular alignment, we get the read due to sequencing errors and unknown variants. In principle, we could just compute the mapping quality from the probabilities over all possible mappings, all possible alignments, but that would be way too slow. So what we do instead, we use some heuristics to determine when we should no longer continue exploring new mappings that, because we believe that they no longer have a significant effect on the mapping quality. And also may want to estimate the probability that the heuristics went wrong, and there would have been a good alignment anyway that we did not find. And the really ugly part, it seems unavoidable that at some point we will spend months with a handful of reads. We investigate why we map these reads confidently, but the mappings are incorrect, and how we can deal with these issues without making the aligner too slow. So we had VG map a few years ago already published, which is with all original VG read aligner. We can understand it as an adaptation of BWAM for graphs. So we have an FME index. We use it to find maximal exact matches, use them as seeds, and so on. It's more accurate than aligners that map short reads to a linear reference, but also something like an order of magnitude slower. Another issue was that index construction is difficult, requires graph pruning, which may or may not help, and takes a day or two for a human graph. And complex graph regions are computationally expensive because the number of possible paths through them grows exponentially with the number of variants in them. Giraffe started as an attempt to deal with the weaknesses of VGMap by, relying less on sophisticated text indexes, use something that's easier to build. Then wanted to use haplotype information to deal with the complex regions, and then wanted to make it faster by avoiding expensive dynamic programming to the extent possible. Yeah. And then this is the data model we have for Giraffe. First, we have a graph, which represents a collection of aligned haplotypes. Positions in the haplotypes that map to the same node in the graph are considered equivalent. Each traversal of the graph is a potential haplotype, but we prioritize traversals that are locally consistent with the original haplotypes because we believe they are more likely to be biologically plausible. And we also store the original haplotypes as paths in the graph. Some terminology. I say path, it could be a walk, it could reuse the same nodes and same edges, but visit them multiple times. But because we don't care about this distinction, I usually only say path. On the other hand, I sometimes talk about paths and sometimes traversals. The idea is a path is something we have stored as a concrete object somewhere. Traversal is something that emerges when we walk around in the graph. Okay, and the key data structure behind Giraffe is a GBWT, effectively a run-length encoded BWT for integer sequences. Usually my talks always contain something that explains the BWT, but I skipped it this time. There should be another talk on Friday, I think, which should focus more on the run-length encoded BWT. Okay. So we have integer sequences, we interpret the integers as nodes, which means that the sequences are now haplotype paths. If the paths are similar enough, the run-length encoding in GBWT compresses them well. We can store them space efficiently. A nice technical trick, we partition the BWT and the rank structure into the nodes, which improves memory locality of the operations in the index. And then, for any graph traversal, we can easily keep track of how many index paths contain the traversal as a subpath. And this is the operation mostly we are using. We traverse the graph and maintain the idea of how many paths are consistent with it, or if there are any paths that are consistent with it. Okay. High level overview of the Giraffe algorithm. First, we use a minimizer index of the haplotypes for finding seeds. Then we cluster the seeds using a distance index, which is based on the hierarchical decomposition of the graph. Then we extend the seeds over the haplotypes, allowing a limited number of mismatches, no indels at this point. And only if we didn't get enough full-length alignments from the extension part, then we use dynamic programming, align the tails of the best partial extensions used over the haplotypes. Now, let's look at each of these steps a bit more closely. First, minimize the seeds. As Eric said, I had a background with BWT, FM indexes, and other sophisticated text indexes. I used to think that text indexes are a big deal in read aligners, but here we decided to do otherwise. We use a minimizer index, which is a simple hash table that maps k merge substrings of length k to graph positions. It's a sparse k merge index, meaning that we don't index all k merge in the reference, only some subset we have chosen. Particularly, we use minimizers, parameters w and k, which means that we choose the k merge with the smallest hash value among all k merge and the reverse complements in a w plus k minus one base pair window, a window consisting of w overlapping k merge. We index all the minimizers into haplotypes because this is just a hash table. We can build the index very quickly, usually 5 to 10 minutes for a human genome graph. If we have a network drive which is lower than about 100 megabytes per second, we can probably build the index faster than read it from disk. Okay. Most minimizers are unique in the graph, but not in the haplotypes. But there are also some minimizers that occur in repetitive regions of the genome, which have too many hits to be useful. So we can't just use all the minimizers we get from the reads as seeds. Instead, for each read, we choose all minimizers with below soft hit cap with at most 10 hits. And then we use a scoring heuristic for the rest of the minimizers, and we may or may not use some with up to 500 hits under the hard hit cap. The idea is that if we have many good minimizers with a few hits, we don't need those worse ones with many hits. But if we have no good minimizers, we need at least some of the less informative ones. And we also try to avoid minimizers with multiple occurrences in the read, because each read position and graph position pair is a separate seed, and that kind of minimizer would be expensive to handle. Okay. Second part, seed clustering. Clustering just basically needs a way to measure distances between graph positions quickly. So we can't use any shortest distance algorithm for that because it could be way too slow. So we use a distance index, a special data structure based on the snarl decomposition of the graph. Okay, it's not really relevant here what the snarl decomposition is, except that it reduces the distances in the graph to distances in a shallow tree, which are much easier to determine. High level, each graph component is a chain of snarls. Chain is a square node in the tree on the right. And each snarl, round node in the tree, is either primitive or it consists of parallel chains. Yeah. Okay, and also this tree is usually very shallow. Most seeds are very close to the top, very close to the root. We can just store the position information in the tree in 64 bits as an extra payload in a minimizer index for the seed. That also speeds up things quite a lot. Third part, seed extension. We extend the seeds in most promising clusters, determine that which are promising based primarily on the fraction of the read covered by the minimizers in the cluster. Before extending, we merge seeds corresponding to the same alignment between the read and a node. Okay, because the nodes can be tens or hundreds of base pairs long, we usually get multiple seeds in the same node. For each seed, we find the highest scoring alignment among all extensions of the seed over the local haplotypes. We traverse the bidirectional GBWT starting on the seed node, find all possible extensions of it, and count the number of mismatches between the relevant substrings of the read and the node. At some point, we can stop the extension for particular seed because we can no longer find anything better than what we already have. We allow any number of mismatches in the seed node, 4 mismatches in total, and 2 mismatches in each flank, left or right from the initial node, even if that would exceed the overall mismatch bound. That's a bit fuzzy heuristic. If we get full length extension, full length alignments, we return those that don't overlap too much. Sometimes we get multiple alignments from the same cluster. Otherwise, we trim the partial extensions in order to maximize their alignment scores, get rid of mismatches close to the end of the extension, and then return all distinct extensions. And finally, the gapped alignment using dynamic programming. If we don't have enough full-length alignments from all clusters, then the read may contain indels that are not present in the haplotypes. Okay, we use dynamic programming over the haplotypes for both left for the tails of the most promising extensions, again, over all local haplotypes. This involves some really ugly, complicated heuristics. I didn't even want to look at the source code to determine if I want to say something about them. And here, because we handle the left tail and the right tail independently, we also may get a recombination into the alignment. So for example, the right, there are 3 local haplotypes, orange, purple, and green. We end up with an alignment consisting of green haplotype for the left tail, which continues with the extension, and orange haplotype for the right tail, which is also consistent with the extension. But there's no haplotype that matches the alignment fully here. Okay, little bonus, paired end mapping. Okay, paired end reads. So we have one read from one end of a molecule, then something in between, and then the pair, its pair from the other strand of the other end of the molecule. Okay. Fragment, if we have a fragment length distribution, the distribution of these lengths of the molecules, we use them. If not, we estimate the distribution doing single end mapping until we have enough confidently mapped read pairs that we can estimate it. Okay, confidently, yeah. Okay, it's mostly the same as single-ended, which I described, except that we cluster the seeds for both reads at the same time and pair clusters that are approximately the right distance from each other. Then we have the special case. We have mapped one read confidently, but its pair is unmapped. So in this case, we try to rescue the pair by extracting a subgraph roughly at the right distance from the mapped read and within 4 standard deviations. Then you use a simplified version of the Giraffe algorithm. Find all seeds in the subgraph, consider them a single cluster, extend them. If we get a full length extension, we use that. If not, we take the best partial extension and align the tails. And this should hopefully get us the right alignment for the pair as well. Okay. Some practical issues here. First, the graph user, the mapping target, may contain components that without haplotype information, for example, decoy sequences or unlocalized contigs. Before we consider the graph as an alignment of haplotypes, those components don't exist in the graph. Okay. Second, each time we add a variant to the graph, it increases the mapping accuracy roughly for samples that contain the variant and reduces the accuracy for samples that don't contain it. If the variant is too rare, trade-off may not be worth it. And third issue, Mapping speed depends on the complexity of graph and the number of distinct local haplotypes. So we have three issues, one solution for them. Instead of using the real haplotypes, we may generate artificial ones with a greedy algorithm that samples, or at least tries to sample, local haplotypes proportionally. Local haplotype here means a k-node, usually four-node subplot. And the best practice we have, that if we have more than about 200 haplotypes in the graph, we downsample them to 64. And in any case, if we have these components without haplotype information, we generate artificial haplotypes for them, just sampling them evenly. Okay. Now, these kind of plots can be difficult to understand if you're not used to looking at them. Basically, vertical axis, true positive rate, we want to be as high as up as possible. Horizontal axis, false positive rate, logarithmic scale, we want to be as far to the left as possible. Three graph types, left, 1000 genomes project human graph, or only small variants, middle, HGSVC, human graph, only large structural variants, and right, 5 yeast strains. Top, single-end mapping, bottom, paired-end mapping. Each curve is a read aligner. Bottom left end is the confidently mapping, maps you 60 reads, top right end, all reads. What we see here is basically that VG map and Giraffe get better results than linear aligners such as BWA MEM with the confident mappings. And then when we move from left to right, from small variants to haplotypes that are far more diverse, the advantage grows bigger, which is kind of what we would expect. Okay, mapping speeds here for a 30x human sample. VG map is much slower than everything else, while various Giraffe parameterizations have similar speeds to BWAMM or a bit better. And memory usage, this is our drawback. We deliberately chose to use more memory for faster mapping. Giraffe usually works within 64 gigabytes of memory. Sometimes it needs up to 96. So it's clearly been designed for running on servers instead of desktops or laptops. But other than that, it's basically combines the speed of linear aligners with the accuracy of VG map, which is what we wanted to do. Okay. And that's it. Thank you. Now, time for questions if you have any.
Thanks, Jouni. There are questions in the matrix channel that we have. It looks like there's still some questions coming. I'll start with a minor one. So Ryan talked about what he called windowed versus universe minimizers. So in the windowed context, you look for the lowest hash of a k-mer value in a particular window. In universe context, you select all the hashes below a certain threshold, basically to subsample the space. And I'm curious if you thought about adapting Giraffe to use a universe minimizer scheme, if you think that would work, or if there might be drawbacks to that for the application.
Okay, let's see. We haven't considered that kind of minimizers. We have considered using sync mers, which are slightly different sparse k-mers. It didn't improve anything really in the overall speed or accuracy, but it required changing some mapping quality heuristics because we are dropping different kinds of information.
I see. So they're kind of zero-sum trade-offs in these tweaks.
Yeah.
Okay, so Andrea Guadagnino asks, instead of filtering out parts of the high-frequency k-mers, have you explored handling weighted k-mers as done in WinnowMap, kind of weighting less high-frequency k-mers or giving less weight to high-frequency k-mers?
Okay, so what is exactly the question.
The question is, if instead of just setting a hard cap on a minimizer having too many hits, if you consider using a weighting scheme where you can, you know, you can use less weight for minimizers, you know, with more than 10 hits or something like that, than you would for the ones that have a unique hit, but you know.
Yeah, okay. It doesn't really fit in the scheme we are using here, because at this point when we are extending the seeds, each minimizer, each seed becomes just a single base pair mapping. And we extend all seeds in the cluster and just find the all these distinct extensions with some traits and return them.
So there's no specific mechanism to weight the minimizer hits. Okay, so Alex Leonard asks, giving the tuning towards aligning over, I mean, through SNPs, I assume, and complicated heuristics for indels, is Giraffe still a superior mapper if you're primarily interested in longer indels?
Now, that's, Giraffe is specifically designed for illuminaries. We assume that sequencing errors are mostly substitutions and that reads are not too long. We are currently experimenting various ideas for long read mapping, but it's not, Giraffe is not for that.
Yes, yeah. And I think if the indels are much longer than the length of the read, you hope they're in the graph so you can genotype them as we did with the structural variants.
Yeah.
Okay. And Jorge Eduardo asks, is there any biological justification for using minimizers? In some way, the fact that they work for representing sequences means that they contain enough information from the entire sequence. This is a philosophical question.
Yeah. Well, we started using minimizers because they were popular ones about 3 years ago when we started this. Other kinds of sparse k-mers became more popular later, but we already had committed to this approach.
Fair. It's a DDS Dom says, what kind of representation do you use for GBWT? So you could refer to the paper maybe, but you can show that. Yeah.
So this is from the GBWT paper. Basically, each node is it's a byte sequence. First header encodes out degree of the node. And then for each outgoing edge, we have the rank structure, destination node, and then rank for the first part that comes from this node to that node. And then after those, we have the barrel flood transform in basically encode the sequence of next nodes as sequence of edge IDs. And then run length encode that. And then we have a sparse bit vector as an index of the bit of this byte array, which we use for finding the compressed representation of the node.
So note that this scheme is inspired the OG dynamic graph model as well. We do a kind of unsorted version of this.
Yeah.
It's very efficient to have node locality. Okay, Massimiliano Rossi asks, so he says, thanks for the talk. I have two questions. One, have you tried to use founder sequences as artificial haplotypes? This is from Dubelli Macken's work. And two, how much the use of the artificial haplotypes affects the accuracy of the alignment?
Okay, now we didn't try using founder sequences because we are operating in node space. The haplotypes are node sequences, and the existing word doesn't really consider large alphabets. And then here in the artificial haplotypes, okay, I don't actually have the results here, but basically sample GBWT, which uses 64 artificial haplotypes for the 1,000 genomes graph, it's both faster and more accurate than the full GBWT with 5,000 haplotypes. The difference is not that large in accuracy, but it's substantial in speed. Here, if on the left, you can find full giraffe in the green, and then sampled lighter green a bit below it. So there's some difference in mapping speed.
Okay, thank you. So Ibioman says, asks, what kind of graph formats does it accept? Does it accept RGFA as well?
Well, RGFA doesn't really work with Giraffe because we ultimately want fully specified parts in the graph to use as haplotypes. So using GFA P lines or W lines. And we convert the graph into our specific format based on the GBWT.
I guess there's another issue there, might be the representation of small variants in the graph is important for the efficiency of the algorithm. It's depending on this exact matching of the reads to SNPs. We did experiments against the linear reference itself, right? It doesn't.
Yeah, and the HGSBC graph also, it's only contains large structural variants, so it should be.
That should be representative, right?
Yeah.
So that's not so much the issue. It's more just making sure the walks are there.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think there is a way to get those by remapping the sequences to the RGFA.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Well, we're at time unless there's any burning questions. Thank you very much, Jouni, for this detailed description of Giraffe, a really exciting tool that I think is going to let us scale a lot of these analyses to much larger population cohorts. So thanks, and look forward to what you're up to next.